I work at Google in San Francisco. And today I'm going to present something about ChatOps. ChatOps is something I started like 5 years ago. It was not intended to be a project like this, but it ended up with now an open source project called Arbot that I'm gonna show you a little bit more. So I'm gonna explain that, and then I'm gonna go through the how you set it up, how you set up Arbot. Then I'm gonna show you how to extend it. So it's a Python project, it's extendable in Python. And then I'll go over like the social aspect of it. So to be sure that in your company this thing gonna be a success. ChatOps has been invented at GitHub, and this is basically DevOps, so DevOps about like automating all your tools, basically automating yourself out of your job, right? and this automation, you connect it to your chat room where everybody is, and you have ChatOps, so you can basically start your tools from the chat, and actually have also like some reporting back from the tools to your chat room. Imagine like a room with people in there, and you have like a special guy in the middle. All are humans except this one, which is like an automated like daemon that gonna answer also like any other participant in the room. So let's go into this hypothetical scenario where you have like a deployment. So a developer just shows up saying, "Yeah, okay, I finished my branch. It's ready. We can start to the deployment process." A project manager comes in to say, "Oh, okay, let's do it." And with like special commands, it asks the bot to, "Oh, let's build it. Like, don't wait for the CI to come in. Just do it right now." The bot answers, saying that, "Oh, this specific build has been started." Here, for example, it's a product manager that comes in, and oh, he was actually preparing the press release, and he followed on the chat room that, "Oh yeah, the developer finally they started to deploy this version. So cool, I can synchronize with them, and whenever it's going to be on production, I will be able to I don't know say to the press just release or whatever we have to announce." So yeah, the bot reports back, "Oh, it has been built correctly, the name of the artifact, for example." And then also it started the test, and all the tests are green, so everybody knows that okay, the basically the artifact is ready. Then and like a more oriented, like let's say ops guy, like an SRE or something, just wants to deploy it in pre-prod. You can also ask the bot. So the bot say, "Oh, okay, it's ready." The product manager can like go there and be sure that, okay, is it really the version we wanted, like a kind of smoke test, and it looks good. So then something in an operation, you could have like a specific way of actually pushing that in production. You can also ask that to the bot, deploy it with, I don't know, a canary of 5% on a specific specific part of your infrastructure. So also you can have also like a kind of a conversation there, like okay, this looks like disruptive for our customers. The bot can actually ask back, I would like to have like one confirmation from one of those persons to be sure that we are not actually breaking something. It's like a kind of a code review, right? So how you can set it up? It's pretty easy. It's so first you need a chat room, like most of you already have one. We support like the most common ones like Slack, HipChat. We have Gitter also, Telegraph, and also the standard protocols like XMPP and IRC. Those ones are pretty useful when you want a private chat room, right? You don't want to Slack or HipChat to host your environment. So to set it up, so it's a Python project like any other. I highly recommend to use a virtual environment. Why? Because the bot you'll see can actually install new packages and actually install dependencies when you're going to install plugins on it. And I also highly, even though the bot can run on Python 2 or 3, I highly recommend Python 3 because we started to move over. And the bot itself is actually developed in Python 3 and then translated to Python 2. Then you need to connect this bot, which is going to run from like a standard process, to your system. So for example, here we ask it to go to Slack, and you can give it like the API token of your chat system. And another thing you need to think about right away is who is going to administer the bot. You'll see the bot, you can actually administer it from the chat itself. So you need actually a limited set of person that's going to be able to change the configuration of the bot. And here we go. So once you are set up, you'll see the bot connecting to your chat room. Then you can also talk directly to the bot, which is recommended for like setting it up. And here you can ask it like rbot.io, r-codebot is actually like a repo on GitHub, and you can ask it to install the plugin, and instantly the new commands out of this plugin going to be available in your chat room. Let's see how you can extend it, right? So this is just like basically the usage. So rbot at the beginning was like a very monolithic, right? It was only XMPP and you basically had like plugins you would hack straight on the bot. But years after years, we added like extension points. So the first one was user plugins. We're going to come back to it. But also the backend. So you saw that we support like a collection of various backends. You can add your own. It's pretty easy. There is a contract you need to respect. You can also so. The plugins can also store some data, so some persistent like some settings and so on. And at the beginning, it was only serialized to disk, but now you can actually also extend it. So we have like storage plugins to be able to connect your bot to SQL databases, Redis, Google Cloud Storage, even Firebase. And finally, so the most important one, the one that is actually interesting for you as if you are writing commands, it's the user plugin. So you can add commands or add features. We'll see that a little bit later. So you can either use like a Git repo internally, or you can, if your plugin you want to open source it, you can put it on GitHub, and it's going to be indexed automatically by the bot, and you'll be able to use it, or other people will be able to use it. One interesting thing there is that all those arrows, especially on the left, right, are actually contract. So basically, user plugin doesn't really have to know which backend you use. We have like a standard way to express, like for example, the formatting of the messages. If you want to make tables or include an image and so on, you just use Markdown. And everything's like identity, for example, the way you identify somebody on a chat system or somebody on that is actually participating in a room or a room itself. All that is actually like opaque objects that the backends give to your plugin, so you don't have to make any specific codes about parsing like GID and XMPP or other identifiers on other systems. Simply, it's a repo, or even like a standard folder in your machine, right? You have to give it like a descriptor with just a name. That's going to be the name of your plugin, and an entry point. That's a Python module that's going to be loaded where rbot going to try to find your plugins. And your plugin itself, you just inherit from bot plugin. That's actually defined the plugin. And then for every command you want to expose on your chat system, you just have to decorate it with a specific decorator. Here it's bot command. We will see like a list of different ones, but that's the simplest one. So simply when you're going to do like make, it will actually trigger the command, and whatever is after the command, it will actually inject that into args. So here you see that it answers straight with a simple return. Answer straight in the chat room the return string that you get. So it's pretty the learning curve is very gentle at the beginning. So if you want to document your plugin, you just have to actually insert doc strings. So I reuse them from the class itself. That's going to be the documentation of a series of commands that you implement below. And for every method you document, it's going to be the documentation of those bot commands. So if there is an help system that an online help system, and that's going to give you straight your command and your plugins. So same thing. Here it's like the goal is to not being distracted by this development, right? You just keep on going, make your code, and it's going to be ready pretty. So on top of that, after this gentle slope, we have like a ton of features. It's almost feature creep at that point, I would say. But we are going to go through some of them that are pretty interesting. One facility is, so what you're going to do when you get commands, right, is you want to know how to parse the parameters. So we added a specific facility just to split, it's a really simple one, split the argument with a string. And that's going to give you, instead of a string in args, like a tuple with the list of the arguments that are already copied. So those things are like things that we noticed that our users were doing over and over and over while they were actually making those commands. And it's just a facility, so a little shortcut for everybody. You can go way more complex. So for example, you can use arc parsing, which is exactly the same API as arc parse, right? From the command line, except that we put that into something into decorators. So if you are familiar with arc parse, you won't be surprised. So you can assign destinations to your parameters and make them put a default, make them typed and mandatory or not, and so on and so on. And that's going to inject to your, so you have to change your signature of your command and match the name simply on your signature. So very, very simple. And there you can have more fine grain commands you would have on a command line. So here we saw only commands, stuff that you will start with, this exclamation mark at the beginning of the line. You can actually change this to anything you want, but you can also listen to every single messages that the bot is actually can be contacted with, and match a regex on it, just with bot match. You pass it on a regex with capturing groups. And here, for your signature, you just have to have a parameter like args called match. That's going to be exactly the regex match as you would do if you are doing it manually. So no surprise again, but it's a nice shortcut. And so sometimes you want to. So the use cases are. Either you want to make the bot a little bit more human, like you say something and it removes things on left and right and captures specific parts, or you can also another use case is when actually other systems are actually posting in the chat room. Sometimes you want to be able to capture some parameters or some specifics. Sometimes you have commands that are actually long, right? You want to deploy on 200 different VMs. And I used generators to actually being able to post an intermediary status of what the bot is doing. So imagine we are doing something like a long between the two yields, right? And it will continue to execute your command and post the result in the chat room. So very Pythonic and pretty intuitive with the return we had before. Just a note, actually, those are strings, but they are actually marked down. So if you want to put more complex things italic or bold or even images and so on, you can. Oh, this one is really interesting too. So all the systems you probably know on the web have a webhook system where actually they can post information back to you, like GitHub, if somebody commits, or I don't know, any system you can think of, and we have a little embedded web server inside the bot that have all the things necessary to actually expose for you endpoints and can parse whatever format you ask it, either a get, a post, or a form, and so on, and can actually call you back when one of those systems is actually posting a webhook to your bot. Here for example, so it works with a lot of defaults. So here the default post and the JSON post on slash echo, because it's the same pattern. So echo is gonna be the name of the endpoint. gonna call you back on your plugin. Other callbacks. So we have actually like more. Those ones are more chat oriented, right? So callback message is almost like the bot match, right? But there, like, it's really all the message gonna go through your plugin. So you can do whatever you want with the message, depending on what you want to do from there, whatever criteria you have. Presence is about tracking who is, for example, coming in a room, leaving. I think there is like also changing topic in a room, and so on. So this is pretty interesting to actually see who is there, who is not there, and so on, and react with the proper actions. When you have an emergency, for example, you want to know if the person is there or not. The last one, the callback mention, is when you... So the chat system have different conventions to actually mention somebody in the chat room, like at GBIN would actually make like a special message or a special notification to this user. So this is a way to actually grab the various mentions you have. For example, if somebody tries to mention somebody who is on call, and it is not there, for example, you can know it with the callback presence. You can then, I don't know, maybe contact him by SMS or whatever. The last feature we added very recently, it's still not released, it's on head, but that could be actually, this is actually another full presentation. It is conversation flows. Whatever we did before was about like having a command and having a response, right? There is no state in there. You could use the storage facility to actually track what you are doing, but it is actually very cumbersome. So you have to track who you're talking to, where you are in your flow. And so once again, we saw this pattern again and again with our users, and we implemented it a little bit differently. So what you do is actually you define a graph from one command to another, and you can the system will actually automatically follow the user. So several users can have like several different conversations with the bot, and knows where it is in this huge state machine, basically. So here there is like a guessing number game where you can start it with try me, guess several times until condition is reached, so you can end the flow. So I would like to talk like quickly on the social aspect. So when 5 years ago we started the project, we realized like a couple of things, right? You need buy-in from your team, because the goal, like I said at the beginning, is that everybody is on the same page, right? On the same chat room. If people are actually not following the chat room, the thing is kind of a miss. So what we did is actually that was probably the first commands we ever implemented, right? We added fun to the chat room. Like, for example, when somebody did a mistake, we had like a funny face palm feature that was posting like a random face palm picture. We had like a plugin that was actually making competitions between our member of the team on stupid games like a Hello Kitty game, and it was tracking people could actually challenge somebody else, and the bot would keep track of the challenge, and then the person would report back who won the game, and then you could see in real time who won and who lost. So this is like interesting to actually catch a little bit the attention on the chat room, right? The other one that was actually that surprised me, it's how Python is awesome for this project. People started to notice that we were doing something also something fun about, like, we were putting like quotes from people in the company, right? Like funny quotes, like people said something, okay, we're gonna put that in the button. And sometimes, so there were a command to say, at any moment somebody could ask who, what this person would say in this situation, and the bot would give back one of those random quotes from this person, funny quotes, right? And there are people that were actually outside the development team started to notice that and say, oh, it's pretty easy, it's just a dictionary, just add to add a quote. And finally, this actually made the bot our own, right? So suddenly it was like a common property, not only from the dev team or ops team, right, but from the entire company. And also it made the understanding of what we are doing outside of the dev team pretty easily. Like people say, oh yeah, yeah, they're adding features. It's actually helping them in their work, and they see what we are doing, right? And they were that was bringing people in the chat room too. So yeah, if you have any questions, that's now is the time. Oh, so the question is where the bot AirBot has been deployed. We have companies like GoDaddy, Uber. I have GoGo InFlight. You know the company that is doing like this Wi-Fi inside the planes, and a lot of like little companies too. That uptake on huge companies were pretty recent, and it was funny when the first time like somebody asked us like, yes, we have a problem. There are 2,000 users on the bot, and the thing is kind of choking. And that's something I never expected. So the question is how does the bot react when it runs a long command? Is it still responsive? Yes, we have actually like a thread pool. So the first command is gonna actually start to run in parallel, and then it's gonna start to be queued. We were thinking about like putting like a real eventing system on top of it. It might happen at some point, but so far it's enough. Actually, five commands is already actually a lot of people using the bot at the same time. Thank you.